The smartest guys around are about to break it down like they won the game of Miller Times.
Well, actually, they didn't really win the game at all.
Survivor know-it-alls.
Yes, that is right. The Survivor Know-It-Alls are back after a double episode, Stephen Fishback.
Wow. Usually the double episodes have like one dud in them, but I thought both of these episodes were fantastic. In fact, I can't think of an episode this season that has not been fantastic. And I don't want to say best season ever because that's someone else's shtick. But I do feel like this is a, you know, it's real good.
It's been a great run so far, and probably neither hour was epic or the best of the season, but still pretty good.
Well, you know, you got the Alec boot and the Carl boot, and any other season, those are like going to be the dud boots. And like here, we're like chewing our fingers over, you know, is it going to be Carl? Is it going to be Allison? Like these are probably the smallest edited characters of the season, but they, you know, they really got a lot of drama out of them. And it's a testament to how no really small, you know, there's been, you know, basically no invisible characters this season. And so there's no like Chelsea scenario where you're like, was she here? Where did she come from? You know, everyone is a big fun character, and it's you know, you've got a really interesting clear divide with and Carl, the story of the David become godfather. How in 3 days did these Davids turn into as much of a mess as the Goliaths took a month?
The HOH-itis. So much to break down here tonight after this double episode of Survivor, and an all-time immunity challenge in my mind in that first hour. We'll talk about that all. And then double exit interview coming up tomorrow. Wow. We will speak to Carl and Alec on the exit interview on Thursday. So be on the lookout for that. And then on the recap, I'll be joined by your friend and mine, the winner of Survivor China, Todd Herzog, is going to be back on the podcast. How about that?
That's pretty good. Is your double up? Do you have both contestants on at the same time?
CBS has done that in the past, and it's not my favorite thing to do.
It's also funny. Like one person speaks, like they kind of like awkwardly chime in on each other's subjects.
Yeah,
it's my favorite.
No, that they have done that before. And
oh, I know.
I think I had Nayanka and Purple Kelly on at the same time in one exit interview going back a ways. That
sad you didn't get to ask Purple Kelly all the pressing questions.
Yeah,
you had
I think
for
I did
her.
Say Purple Kelly. I'll get to you. Let me start with Nayanka here, and then they did a lot with the finales too. You get like you get like the third place and fourth place. Okay. Yeah. And then also we'll have on the feedback show, Rourke Luskin will be here in the studio for this week's feedback show. And then of course Wiggle Room coming up next week. Stephen,
wait, Rob, I actually have something to promote here.
Oh.
I'm launching a podcast, I think next week.
Yes, go on.
Yeah, it's where I'm going to be. It's a literary podcast. It has nothing to do with Survivor. Where I'm going to be interviewing authors about their the openings of their books and also how they got their first steps in their career. So it's going to be themed around literary beginnings. You know, talking from a thematic and a craft perspective about like the openings of their novels. And my first guest is going to be Jeff Vandermeer. I'm recording it tomorrow. I'm so nervous and excited about it.
Do you need any advice?
Yeah, give me some advice, some good interview advice.
Don't do a lot of banter to open the show. People don't like that.
I thought people liked the banter.
That's what everybody thinks. That's what all the hosts think.
I guess on that note, we should start talking about the episode.
No, okay. Well, please, you know, be sure to let everybody know when there's something to listen to.
Yeah, I will. I will. I'm teasing it now because yes. I don't actually have it up yet.
Congratulations on the new venture. Of course, hashtag RJP to get your questions here in the show as Stephen and I talk this all through. So, Stephen, we did have this big blind side of Carl in the second hour tonight. And I really would love to dig in with you on whether, from the perspective of Christian and Gabby, was this the right call to make here at the final nine?
Well, I definitely think it's the right call from Gabby's point of view, right? Because Carl is leaving her out of the alliance. And that's something that, you know, that can become a trend, right? If you're left out of one conversation and then suddenly they're keeping you out of multiple conversations, you know, Carl is cutting Gabby out from her alliance and he's replacing her with Angelina. So I think from Gabby's point of view, it makes sense to get rid of someone who's not necessarily working with her. And, you know, especially when it's talking about saving Allison, who is working with her. You know, I think it's a little more complicated from Christian's point of view because he's still very tight with Carl, right? He's very tight with the Davids. You know, basically Christian's insulation in this game is this David power structure that has been protecting him for the last couple of weeks. And, you know, he himself acknowledged, like, I'm this giant threat. I need to keep threats around. I think for Christian, it was not a good move. What do you think, Rob?
You know, I did think about it more from Christian's perspective, and I was a little surprised that I felt like he went all in with Gabby, because the way that I'm sort of looking at it is that, you know, we're going into the final eight next week, and now Christian has blindsided three of his allies he's blindsided Carl. He's on the jury now, and he's blindsided Davey and Nick, and was Carl the bridge to Angelina? Is Angelina still in with them? And then on the other side, it seems as though you have Allison and Mike and Kara, and they could easily, you know, stick together as, you know, what's left of the Goliaths. And it does seem like that, you know, Christian and Gabby seem like they're in the middle, which may or may not be a great place to be. And I think that they really now have to zigzag their way. I don't see a straight shot for them to get to the end. Now, the thing that I'm sort of curious about is now Allison has been very close with Gabby. And then we saw her at the start of the second hour hugging Christian of let's work together. So maybe Gabby and Christian feel that especially great about Allison, that she is their third, but still three out of eight, the other two sides could come together and pick them off.
Yeah, I think, I mean, that's why I think it makes like a lot, you know, I do think it makes sense for Gabby to keep an ally like Allison in the game. You know, she's keeping an ally like Christian in the game, and she's eliminating someone who's, you know, who's not really that interested in working with her and with whom she feuds. Like, to me, that is a sensible move for Gabby, who has not really been a target, right? Certainly since the merge, she's not really been a target. Versus for Christian, where, yeah, they're caught between these two groups. You're going to have one group that's angry at you, you know, with the Davids. You're going to have this other group that doesn't necessarily feel such strong ties to you. You know, Mike and Angelina have consistently voted for Christian. And I really think, I think the one thing that was saving him was this like sense of unity among the Davids, the sense of like, we're all in this together. We've all got our like super special powers. That said, I don't think Nick is going to hold it against him, right? Like, Nick's a player. Like, he's gonna respect the move.
Yeah. You think so? That Mason Dixon went behind his back? I mean, wasn't this the same exact thing that Gabby got so upset with Carl about? Of like, hey, it's called an alliance. Do you remember what game we're playing? I mean, that Christian went and made this plan behind Nick's back. I can't think that Nick and Davey are going to react well to this.
I mean, it's not the greatest thing that happens, but I'll bet Nick is like, you know, like, I would imagine Nick is pretty understanding about this one. Like, I mean, you know, this is, you know, he was saving his ally Gabby, right? Mm-hmm. Who he was saving their other friend Allison. I mean, Nick was in an alliance with Allison, right? The brief Strike Force, which, really, looking back, why did we ever learn about Strike Force?
Well, I do think that Strike Force, there was a flirtation in terms of that it was going to happen and then it didn't happen and then it almost happened with Kara in for Mike. And I thought it was actually very interesting that the team that won the reward in the first
hour
was all Strike Force. And so there was a little bit of like a turnabout of the Davids being with Alex's very colorful metaphor of working them for tips like he does in real life. But Steven, just going back to this, we're at the final eight next week. I mean, I feel like there's a non-zero chance that, you know, there's three votes on Christian and three votes on Gabby next week, and we flush Christian's idol and one of them goes home.
I think that's right. I absolutely think that's right. I think there's a good chance that, I think Christian is in a big thing. I mean, Christian himself said this episode, you know, it's been my overall theory that his overall theory that he has to keep threats around, yes, in order to protect himself. Now, this episode, he voted off the two people who everyone says are the big threats. Now, the idea that Carl is a big threat guy, it's a little foisted on us a little bit quickly.
Came out of nowhere.
But, yeah.
The Godfather, Don Corleone.
I wish I had had Don Corleone. That's so good. How did I not get that? Oh my God, that's terrible. How did I not get that? But
get me a beer.
Carl to me is the kind of person you want to keep in Survivor, right? Mm-hmm. He's a big focal point. Everyone is like fixated on Carl and what Carl doing. And he's also very loyal to the Davids. And most importantly, he tells you what he's going to do. Like when Carl has a plan, he tells everyone what his plan is. Like that's who you want.
He doesn't just tell you. He tells the people on the other side on the plan. Yeah, everybody gets to know the plan. Yeah. So Carl did play very poorly in both these rounds, other than in the challenges. He was pretty good in the challenges tonight, but he played poorly in terms of giving too much information away. But if we're going to look at these two episodes, you know, together as one piece here, now, if Christian was going to go ahead and blindside Carl in the second hour, was it a mistake to vote out Alec in the first hour?
Right. I mean, that's sort of, you know, that's hard. That's a hard thing to say after the fact, I guess. But I guess you're right. Like, you have to think at least two votes down the line.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, obviously, you know, the situation on the beach changes very quickly, and that's especially true once you get down to single digit mm-hmm. layers. But that's an interesting point. Like, why vote out Alec if you're just going to vote out Carl? That's interesting. So you think he should not have voted Alec at all?
Well, I don't want to say that is 100% my opinion, but I think it's worth exploring because I thought that Christian was making a lot of sense when he talked about, hey, everybody's worried about me as the biggest threat out here. So why don't I keep somebody out here who's going to be a bigger distraction and everybody's going to be super focused on Alec, and then I could, you know, keep him around. Now that's one extra Goliath that you're keeping in the game, and so it does make it harder for, I feel like, that Christian and Gabby have each other, but I don't know necessarily the grouping in which they have a majority in. They're sort of like the, in any way you slice up the pie, not to go back to pie, but any way you slice it, I don't feel like that they are in any group where they outnumber the rest of the group.
Yeah, I mean, I think the danger with Alec especially is he's so physically dominant that there is sort of the chance that he could win out. And that becomes very threatening when you're looking at a jury that will probably be largely composed of Goliaths.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know what the next move is. I feel like that this is now going to be... Now, Christian and Gabby, in talking, they mentioned, hey, look, now we just got a pendulum, this thing. And we go back to sort of like, this idea of, okay, vote off somebody from one alliance, vote off somebody from the other alliance, and go back and forth. So I just don't know necessarily if they're going to be able to pull this off.
Yeah, so you don't think they're going to stay, you don't think this alliance of Christian, Gabby, Allison, Mike, and who's the fifth in that group?
Kara,
you don't think that they are going to stay strong together?
You think they'll pick everybody off going down the Angelina, Davey, Nick will be the next three boots in some order?
I don't know. That's, I'm asking you. I mean, I could. I mean, I don't.
But
I don't.
Do you want really because there? Here's the thing. If you're Christian and Gabby, do you want to go to the final five with Allison and hope she's going to pick your side over Mike and Kara? I mean, if you're Allison, why would you go to the end with Christian and Gabby?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, but I think for Christian, like, why is anyone going to the end with Christian, right? Mm-hmm. Like, who are the people who are even going to take him to the end? And I guess maybe that actually is a rationale for Alec. Like, maybe Alec isn't as threatened by Christian, you know, because he's, I don't know. It's a really tough one. I just wonder if there was any way that you don't vote out Alec in that spot, given how visible he is, given how fixated your alliance is on getting him out. Mm-hmm. And if you do vote out Carl, like, then what happens? Like, let's say they vote out Carl before they vote out Alec, then they've given the Goliaths the majority again. Like, they just have spent all of this time evening up the numbers. I mean, let's not forget, in the first vote, right, it's even numbers, and the eliminating Alec gives the Davids the majority for the first time in the game, you know, since Pat got pulled. So for them to just go and vote out one of their own
the numbers are back to 4-4 after this.
But they briefly had a majority by voting on Alec. And so I think, like, if I were the Davids, I would never want to just be at the Goliath's mercy once again.
Let me ask you about an alternate plan. Tell me if this is better or worse. What if Christian and Gabby voted with the other Goliaths and they blindsided Angelina at that vote? Would Davey and Nick and ultimately Carl be more forgiving of voting out Angelina? They took out a Goliath, but she was somebody that Gabby and I were feeling like we didn't like her being part of the alliance, and we had to take her out. I mean, then where are the other Davids going? Are then Carl and Davey and Nick going to go with Kara and Mike to vote against Gabby and Christian at the next vote?
I don't know why you would vote out Angelina ever. You know, she seems to me like exactly the kind of person, like, you know, not similar to Carl, but for she also seemed like Carl to be a kind of person who you would really want in Survivor. You know, she reminds me a little of Erin Lobdell, where you know from Token Sheens, where A, you don't think she's ever going to win, and then B, you know she's going to make a self-interested strategic decision. You know, so, like, those are two really useful metrics for keeping someone in the game. Like, you know that the jury doesn't like her, and you know that she's always going to do the rational strategic thing.
Yeah.
Like, again, like, why? I don't see why you take her out.
Well, I would say that the reasoning would be that you can still make your move here and then ultimately keep... That I can explain that more to Carl and to Davey and to Nick about why we did what we did, and now let's get this back to being, you know, David, you know, the Davids.
Oh, you're saying. I'm sorry. You're saying for the second boot, rather than vote out Carl, vote out Angelina.
Yeah. What do you think? What do you think of that?
Because I like that, actually, because that takes, like, that sort of, like, removes. Yeah, it takes out Carl's power base, like, kind of, like, forces Gabby back in there, essentially, but doesn't actually betray them. That's a fun idea.
Yeah, I mean, it's still a betrayal. It's still you went behind our back and did that, but I kind of feel like that's the kind of thing where Christian can say to Nick and to Davey, maybe, like, this is why we had to do this, because Angelina was, you know, well, we were feeling, you know, pushed down in the pecking order. And I don't know what those guys are going to do. Like, Kara seems like she has a working relationship with Carl and Davey, but I mean, then Mike and Allison are going to vote with them next week to vote against Christian and Gabby. I don't see it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I do think this is the point. I remember, like, with the fire making challenge, there's only, like, four votes left in this game. And I really think they've got to, right at this point, you've really got to think, who do I need to get out more than how do I, you know, tweak this?
Well, what are the criteria? Are you looking at who can make a fire? Or are you looking at who can ultimately win in front of the jury?
Yeah, who's going to beat me? A, who's going to take me to the end? And B, who's going to beat me if I'm there with them? I think those are the two big criteria. Mm-hmm. And, you know, right?
Yeah, I don't. It's such a crapshoot. Then when you get down there, so I guess you feel like they get out anybody that you can that possibly can beat you. But I think you also have to then say who's going to stay loyal to you to get you to that point.
But it doesn't matter, right? That's what I'm saying. Like, you need the people who are going to be with you to get you there. But ultimately, like, loyalty doesn't matter if they're just going to beat you in the end anyway, right? It doesn't matter if they're your best friend until day 39. I mean, I'm obviously speaking from deep personal things.
Yeah, I hear that. Some other things from the episode tonight. For Angelina, she opened up a negotiation with Jeff Probst tonight in the episode. What did you think of that?
We've talked about a lot how you don't ever really want to be the person who's like putting yourself out there in those situations. I tweeted like to me initially her negotiation tactic seemed a little bit ridiculous, where she came to Jeff saying, this is our initial offer and we know that it's a low ball. Like, and the idea of starting a negotiation by saying, this is a bad offer that you shouldn't accept, seemed like a bad idea. So Angelina responded to this tweet. Let me just go pull up what she said. And she gave a little bit of insight into why she played it this way. She said, it was part of my strategy. In many other negotiations on the show, Jeff Probst will immediately shut it down. I wanted to show willingness to make it work so he didn't just shut the door in my face. I knew my ceiling and the offer I accepted was below it. I think that's actually not a bad point. It's like if you come to Jeff and are like, here's what we're willing to give you, there's a very good chance that Jeff is going to come back and say, actually, I'm taking everything.
Yeah. That's a good point. I do remember in Survivor of the Amazon, Jenna and Heidi had started off with Jeff, we will take our socks off for a wedding cake. That's a low ball offer. Just okay. Feel free to give us a counter in terms of that. It seemed like it was the reaction from the other players and in the moment didn't seem like that was going over great, but people did seem happy afterwards. But boy, Angelina, I'm surprised that she did not strain her back like Pat trying to pat herself repeatedly for her contribution.
No, she's not the hero. I'm not the hero. Yes, I saved us all rice and here it is. We have enough, yeah. But it's not about me.
Yeah. I thought that Jeff actually let them off remarkably easy of like, who wants to sit out of the immunity challenge? And Angela's like, oh, all right, I'll take one for the team, everybody. I'll sit out of the immunity challenge just so we can eat. But I did this for you. I mean, if I was Jeff, what do you think of this? Okay. Somebody is not going to play in the immunity challenge and is starting tribal council tonight with one vote.
Oh, wow. That's fun.
One person.
I like that.
You started. Look,
you're going to Samoa.
You're going because everybody starts saying, like, well, look, she's already got one vote against her. Like, what do you think? Nick's got a one vote already. Come on. I thought that was such a, like, Jeff's like, no, that was a low ball offer. Now, this is what I want. One person not playing in the immunity challenge today. It should have been, you don't get to play immunity the rest of the season.
Yeah. Or like next one, like not playing immunity today, you already see what the challenge is. You know, you're not going to win it or, you're not going to be competitive. Then right. Yeah. Oh, I would have sat that one out too. You know? Yeah. Rice for everybody. Sure. Mm-hmm. And the thing though, is that which we do talk about a lot is like being the person to do that is never that useful because, you know, it only ends up having a bad impact, right? People somewhat resent and target the person who makes that sacrifice, but they never reward you for that.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, she only brought it up like a million times after, and like it will be the cornerstone of her final three speech as well if she gets there. Do you guys remember that time that we had no rice and everybody was starving and I made the ultimate sacrifice?
I want to give her credit, though, for the way she brought it up to the jury. And yes, it was very heavy-handed and very obvious, but I do think there's something to the fact of like, you need to make the jury like know what you're doing. You need to let the jury in on your game so that they can see your point of view. And when you get to the end and you say, I did all these things, like there's some justification for that in their minds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, let's not spend too much time on this. I do want to talk about that first immunity challenge tonight, Stephen, which I felt like really just had everything. I was watching it with the biggest smile on my face. And every time I thought it couldn't get better, it just kept getting better where we got to. And it really shifted a couple times for me where I felt like, okay, Alec is winning this immunity challenge because you get to down to where it's three people left and it's Alec and it's Gabby and it's Christian. And, you know, Gabby is getting all, is all upset and she's crying because, hey, why don't these guys give up? This is the challenge that I'm supposed to win. This is the one I can win. And it hurts so much. And why, you know, why are these guys holding on? And then she drops out. And then Alec, so brazen that he was just I'm going to win this challenge. You're going to lose. You're going to drop. You're gonna drop down. And just repeatedly, he's like the Dread Pirate Roberts. He was incredible.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. It was really cool. It was kind of a beautiful moment. And the interesting thing was like Christian didn't seem to be suffering. I like the psychological warfare. Well,
then it shifts again, where it's like, you know, there's Alec in the face of adversity is like, no, you can't beat me. I will win this challenge. You're gonna drop. You're gonna lose. He says to Christian, and then Christian starts with actually. Jeff, can I talk? Can I tell a story? And then Carl's like, no, Christian, gotta concentrate. He's like, no, I got this. I'm like, all right, you go, go for it, babe. And then Christian begins on this story, and the edit was so beautiful,
so good, so beautiful.
And then just you see him talking about like crazy things. I once read a book about plants, and then Jeff, what's a Reuben sandwich? He's doing like all these things that are just these factoids, and then the pained look on Alec's face. It was like something out of a sitcom where
it really was.
Alec was wilting under Christian, going on and on and on, to the point where then the shots on his face, the pain reaction, to where he became physically nauseous. And then it turned again, where then Alec said to Christian in such an earnest way, he's like, but Christian, you don't understand. I'm going to go home. I need this. And Christian says to him, I know. And it was like the Han Solo moment.
Yeah.
It was like, it really Han Solo, I love you. I know.
Yeah, I know.
And then Christian held on to win. Oh, it was epic. It was epic. And, you know, the Alec vote, even though I did think that it was going to be, Alec was going to stay ultimately at that vote. It was a unanimous vote. Like Alec was afraid of. It was such a great moment.
Yeah, it was great. It was a really, really great moment. It was an epic challenge. And it was fantastic. And then Alec had a beautiful confessional after. Yeah. And then it's a true David versus Goliath story.
Yeah. Well, you know, Jeff loves it when the final two in any challenge is David versus Goliath. Yeah. And then, but then the Christian just held on, and it was, rankings can be arbitrary and reductive, Stephen, but I have to say that it
what?
Was.
What? It, Rob Cesternino saying rankings are arbitrary and reductive?
It has to be.
Who is that?
In my mind, it was a top 10 challenge, and I have to get Mike Bloom on an off-season podcast to figure out the greatest survivor immunity challenges, because that one to me just had everything. It was the highlight of the night.
Yeah. Now, is it a great challenge because of this epic showdown, or because of the way it's edited, or is the challenge itself a great challenge?
You know, I saw Mike Bloom had tweeted this out, that the previous time they had run this challenge was probably another thing that's going to be in that top 10 if you were going to make that list, going back to Survivor San Juan del Sur, when it was Reed and Natalie Anderson in that one-on-one showdown where Jeff and Jeff was actually bringing out different temptations, which he did not do this time out. So I don't know what it is necessarily about being in that position where it just sort of like facilitates that you're able to talk and have conversation as you're, it's a long challenge. And maybe so if you keep the survivors out there for 5 or 6 hours, you're going to get some gold for a 5-minute sequence, as opposed to an 8-minute challenge that, you know, it's going to, you know, people have to concentrate. So it was so great. And so that, you know, both these times that they've run this challenge, amazing results. And this one was better than that one. And that's an all-timer also, Natalie Anderson versus Reed.
Yeah. It's fantastic. It was really great. The editing was great. The whole story around it was great. And then the afterwards moments were fantastic. Like Alex Teary confessional, like, I don't want to be some unanimous vote.
Yeah.
And he was.
Yeah. Alec has been an interesting character in this season, and somebody who I think a lot of us, and I'm looking at myself in the mirror, did not expect much from. But I feel like he really delivered in the season.
Yes, I agree. I think we all came in with the F it picture in our minds, thinking like another douchey bro, and like he's going to be a total dud, and you know maybe he's going to get a bad edit as revenge. But that's not at all what happened. Like, he was a really great, fun character.
Yeah,
he was a lot of fun. He brought a lot of personality and charisma to that spot. You know, to that casting spot, and he got a very full, interesting, generous edit. There was,
Steven, I've seen people say tonight in the chat and on Twitter that he got a bad edit tonight. Did you think so?
No, I thought he was really sympathetic.
No, I didn't think so either. I didn't think so either. I saw a couple of people saying that, like, oh, they're really bad. Like, I guess that they were showing him saying that he was going to win the challenge, and then he didn't. But I thought that was such a great character moment, and so I thought he was really great the whole way through. So
I mean, his back was against the wall. He wasn't he wasn't just like picking on people. He was like putting his all into a desperate attempt to save his fate in Survivor, which I think like anyone could. Understand.
Yeah. Going back to the second vote tonight, Mike White was the big swing. And I thought that maybe it was turning around where Mike was potentially going to end up being in jeopardy after there was some talk where Christian was talking about how
the beard sand,
and Christian, talking about, I thought it was very fun when Mike was talking about how, you know, in addition to being a writer and producer, I'm also an actor and I am having to act my ass off out here right now. And then, but then when Christian identified, like, what? Hold on a second. Mike is an actor. He could be playing all of us. And then I was like, uh-oh, is this turning around on Mike? But no, he was the swing that at least on what we saw from the edit, that it seemed like that this vote was going to hinge on him. Any thoughts that Mike might have made the wrong decision?
Huh. I mean, no, I don't think so. I mean, Mike has always been pretty Goliath strong.
I don't think so either. But that, I mean, it was presented as, for Mike, do I want to get rid of Carl, who, you know, is the godfather, but, you know, at least, you know, I know where he is, or Allison. And he called Allison Wonder Woman.
Yeah. It's that lasso of invisibility.
It's not a lasso of invisibility. She has an invisible jet, but it's a lasso that makes people tell the truth. Right.
Tell the truth. Allison and Mike seem to have, I mean, I guess Allison has really wavered. Yeah. Like, her storyline this whole season has been her oscillating between, you know, do I make a move? Do I not make a move? I actually thought Allison had a bad night tonight, where I really felt like the sense of, I've missed the boat. This is
not the Survivor speedboat.
No, not the Survivor speedboat. Really, they kind of like I had like shades of Laurel from Allison, where I feel like Survivor wants to remind contestants to make moves, and otherwise, you know, they're going to be in trouble.
Get hung out to dry. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like that Allison has had a few bad nights in a row. I think going back to the merge where she won immunity and had a good episode, but that, you know, she's stuck in there, and, you know, she's in an interesting spot moving forward. But I do think that the relationship to watch from the Goliath side happens to be between Mike and Kara. And we really haven't seen it described explicitly on the show, but that I feel like that those two are super tight. And I feel
Mike and Kara.
Yes.
Huh.
What do you think of that?
I didn't think of that. Why do you say that? No, I believe you, but tell me, I hadn't seen it.
Well, I feel like that then otherwise, who is Mike tight with from this group? And then, you know, they're sort of like, I feel like that they're sort of the Goliaths that are outside with Allison. Like, Allison is off working with, talking with Christian and Gabby. But I felt like that, especially like they were on the reward with Davey and with Carl. I just felt like it seemed like that they have a bond.
Yeah, they are sort of the last of that like former Goliath. I guess Angelina was in the Goliath strong group too for a while. But I bet like with eight, you know, there have been so many mixes. I will bet it's pretty mixed up at this point. You know, I bet that in general on the beach, it's a little bit, but I believe that Mike and Kara have a connection.
Let me talk about the second immunity challenge tonight, because I actually have a little bit of an issue with the second immunity challenge. And I know that you are certainly an authority on fairness and games. So tell me, hear me out on this, Stephen.
Yeah.
I think that Carl, when the survivors were told, all right,
this is a tough one.
You have 13 blocks. You need to spell the 11-letter word. Okay. And there, Carl goes up there and he puts it like, Jeff, I got it.
Yeah.
Perception.
Perceptions.
Perceptions. Yeah. Now, if it is perceptions is a word.
Yeah, I think so. It's the plural of perception.
Or, you know, that we had what, different perceptions of what was going on? You would say that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Sure.
All right. Because I don't want somebody, you know, some, you know, grammar or, you know, like, actually we all had a different perception of what's going on. You can't have different perceptions.
You can have different perceptions.
Okay. Just wanted to before I tried to make a point, I just wanted to make sure with,
no,
you know.
I'm willing to give you the grammar go-ahead on this.
If you play Scrabble with Stephen Fishback, you're in for a world of hurt, okay? So perceptions, I mean, this was not the answer to a crossword. This was not the answer to a riddle. We're looking for an 11-letter word, and you have 13 blocks. I felt like, well, no, that is an 11-letter word, but it's not the 11-letter word that I was thinking of. So no, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I kind of agree. I mean, I guess I saw like, well, it's not our word, but like he did solve a puzzle, found an 11-letter word. It is obviously related to, you know, the exact same theme that perspective is. Mm-hmm. I kind of think they should have let it play too.
Yeah, I kind of felt like, I mean, I don't know what the call is on that. And I don't know if this is necessarily a hot take, but if it wasn't like there was, and again, as far as what we saw in the episode, there was no sort of like a, you know, crossword clue of this is something that you'll need to, you know, it's a word for, and the words are actually very similar too in terms of, you know, the definition. So, this, I just don't know. I felt like that, it's fuzzy to me.
Yeah. It's a really, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I see why they said like, that's not the answer to this puzzle, but like he solved the puzzle. Like he did find a result to the puzzle that like did seem to, it's a,
you know, it's,
one.
And it's not like Wheel of Fortune where it's like the letters are there and you solve the puzzle and it's like, yeah, that would work, but that is not what the letters actually are. Like it was, you know, so, and it wasn't like,
And like the fact that he goes home on it, it's pretty. Yeah.
And I was a little disappointed because I felt like, ooh, this will be so good that they're gonna try to blindside Carl and then he wins immunity and now everybody has to scramble or get poached, one or the other. And so ultimately, so bad luck for Carl there that it wasn't the word.
Yeah. Bad luck for Carl.
Yeah. What are you gonna do? All right, Stephen. What else from tonight's episode?
Gosh, there was so much good stuff in the episode. You know, certainly we talked about Gabby. You know, you never actually made clear. Do you think this was the right move for Gabby to take down Carl?
You know, I feel like that Gabby is probably the most boxed in out of anybody coming into this vote because I don't know necessarily where she's going to go. It's almost like that if you were going to be sort of like drawing the chart, the alliance chart, that I feel like that, you know, Gabby has like the connection with Christian and a connection with Allison. And then if you were going to sort of like try to figure out who she has if you're doing the Brant steal of the season, does she have a level 3 alliance with anybody else? Not really from what we've been seeing on the show. We don't really see her having any other connections. I'm sure she is having conversation, but I don't know. And I wondered if she was more insulted by Carl to make this move here at 9. Christian still has an idol. I wonder if for Christian and for Gabby, if they could have made this move at 7. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think that would have been the correct play. I mean, like I really do think that like this is, I mean, again, like for Gabby, I you know, when it's between two people and one of them is your ally and one is actively working against you, you know, to me that's like pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm. You know, it's especially at this stage of the game. I really don't think it's probably, you know, the lines are clearly not as neat as,
now,
as Jeff said. The lines are blurred.
But just to talk this through,
I think this was a good move for Gabby. I think she made the right play. I do think for Christian it was a little premature. But I don't know how Christian could have played it, because you know, he can't go vote and then leave his ally Gabby in the dark. Maybe he tells her, listen, you're not in on this one because everyone thinks you like Allison. Mm-hmm. But you know, I just wanted you to know, and can you like please not blow up our game?
Yeah. So the tricky part here is for them to wait to get to seven. That would be much easier if Allison was still in the picture. If hypothetically they were going to be voting out Kara at this,
right? Because who do they flip with? Yeah.
Because then who are they going to flip with? Because now, based on the way that Angelina ended up, who I really thought coming into tonight's episode, I thought she was going to be a goner. So I have to give her credit for being able to ingratiate herself into working with the Davids, because I thought she was next to go. It actually sort of like flipped back around where those people that voted against Angelina ended up kind of at the bottom in the last from the previous tribal council, where Angelina was able to flip, outflip them, the people that we're talking about were being in the strike force. But to get to seven now, okay, so now Allison is going to be gone, and then either Kara or Mike is going to be the next target. And so now if you're Gabby and Christian and you want to flip against Carl, now you have to get, you know, Angelina and whoever's left from Kara and Mike to vote with you. And it looked like that Angelina is, right there as one of like Carl's top lieutenants now.
Yeah. Good on Angelina, by the way, for, you know, just the Goliath voted against her and she has integrated herself very quickly with that David group.
Yeah. I mean, I don't see a path for her to get to the end unless it's somebody is saying like, okay, well, I feel like that she can't win, but she's going to outlast a lot of these Goliaths, it looks like.
Yeah. And she's her willingness to bounce around, I think is going to be a strength for her now. I totally can see her making it to the end. I mean, partially because I think people,
I'd be here for it.
I love Angelina.
She's really good.
She's great. She's really, this whole cast, there's so many all-time characters in this cast, and she is absolutely
She's very fun. Okay. Steven, anything else before we start to get towards the questions?
Yeah, I had another question for you, but I've just totally forgot. Oh, is Christian, do you think Christian is one of the most beloved characters in like when was the last time we had a character who was as universal beloved as Christian?
By the players or the fans?
By the fans, like by every part. Obviously there are certain people who are going to be outraged that I'm saying this. They hate Christian. But from what I've seen, you know, both in terms of the casual fans, the mythical, you know, people on the street and the, you know, the online fans, it seems pretty universally pro-Christian.
That has gone for a deep run in a season. I feel like that... Spencer, the first time out, I feel like it was universally popular, but maybe not even quite as popular as Christian. I'm trying to think off the.
I always think Joe, but Joe had his detractors. I mean, JT is probably it, right? Like, someone said online said Malcolm, which I think
Malcolm.
A really
I think that probably you know Malcolm. I would say Malcolm during Karen Moen, I think was sort of like universally popular, sort of like polling at 100%.
Malcolm in all of his seasons, actually. Malcolm in the last one too. People were crazy about Malcolm.
Yeah, I mean, Malcolm's a super likable, charismatic guy. I mean, not to speak anything about his Survivor game, but he's incredibly likable
and like smart. Yeah, he's like athletic, strategic. He's the whole package.
The whole package. Okay. All right. Steven, before we get to our questions from the audience, I want to take a moment and thank our sponsor, our friends over at Quip. And
Quip.
Steven, of course, holidays are right around the corner and there's a buzzy gift on everybody's list this year. And it is something they'll use twice a day. It was featured on Oprah's O-List and it's perfect for everyone with a mouth. It's a Quip.
I actually have a Quip.
Yes. How are you like now, Steven? You once famously revealed that your ultimate pickup line before you were a married man was you would ask
whatever
women,
this is. It's false. No one.
You would ask women, do you floss before or after you brush your teeth? So everybody knows you are an authority on dental hygiene.
This was this. That was a joke.
That was a joke. That, I didn't know that was a joke. The retcon. You were making a quip.
Yeah, yeah. Wait, where are we going?
Quip. Your quip. How is it? How do you like it?
I really like it. I really like it. It's an electric toothbrush, you know, and it's a portable. It's small. It's battery operated. It's very efficient. I love it. I love my quip.
They've got a great offer for our listeners. You can get it at a stocking stuffer price, just $25, when you go to getquip.com/Rob. I'm gonna read this like Jeff Probst, like it's a reward. Sensitive sonic vibrations, gentle enough on your sensitive gums, with a built-in timer and guiding pulses to remind you when to switch sides. Worth playing for? Of course it is. And your dentist approves as well. It doesn't require a clunky charger like all these other electric toothbrushes, and runs for 3 months on one charge. Okay. So, Steven, it's also the first electric toothbrush accepted by the American Dental Association, has had thousands of verified 5-star reviews. I've got a quip as well. I love it. It looks like it's from the future. It's very fun. It sticks to the wall. And that's why they have over 5,000 verified 5-star reviews. Quip looks like a big ticket tech gift with a stocking stuffer price starting at just $25. And if you go to getquip.com/Rob, you'll get your first refill pack for free with a Quip electric toothbrush. But you don't have to tell the person you bought it for how cheap it was.
Oh, even. Yeah. Yeah. That's another thing. It's like they send you brush heads and batteries.
Yes, nice. So that's your first refill pack at getquip.com/Rob. All right. Let's get into the questions here with the great Stephen Fishback. Stephen, you want to take the first question from Tara?
Yeah, Tara Renee wants to know, I'm surprised Carl didn't know how close Christian and Gabby are. Are they successfully keeping their close relationship under wraps despite working with so many people? Or was Carl just blinded by power and beer?
Yeah, Carl did have a few beers. Carl loves beer.
That was another great moment. How do we not talk about the drunk Carl moment?
What do you want to say?
It was great.
It was great. Drunk Davey was fun too.
Yeah. You know what was also great? Another shout out to the editors when they in the challenge right before Angelina speaks, how they like they have like the ramp up challenge music and then it like kind of like peters off.
No, I love the editing has been something. There was like a wipe that they did with like a bamboo pole. I don't know if you caught that also, that they did like a transition of like the camera like went across and like the scene changed. It was fantastic stuff. But Steven, do you get crunked like Carl did on a reward?
I don't even think I've ever. It's
you
dangerous.
And JT, not even when you were eating all that meat, you didn't get all drunk.
Oh, I got a little drunk, there. And I actually had a beer at a reward. Your body. The thing is, you're having so little food, and that and even a little bit of alcohol goes right to your head. And it looked like Carl had more than a little bit of alcohol.
Yeah, look, I got drunk, a time or two on Survivor.
Yeah. Did you?
Yeah. A couple times. I mean, I got pretty like after the merge feast, they gave us like a whole bunch like cooler of Coors Light. And I was like, okay, sure. It was fun. Survivor is fun. Survivor's fun.
Survivor ain't fun. Going on a cruise is fun.
What do you do on a cruise?
You play Survivor
and drink
games?
And drink.
Okay.
Okay. And so look, it was nice. It was fun. I didn't, people think that I was throwing up. I never threw up from drinking on Survivor. That never happened. And, it was fun, but as a grown up, I wouldn't do it. You know, I played Survivor when I was a kid.
Yeah. Yeah. This last time I didn't have any booze at the merge feast just for that very reason. It's like, you know, you're going to say something stupid. You're going to fall asleep. You're going to miss an important conversation. You're going to, you know, sit in your hammock and act like the Godfather.
Yeah. All right. Let's take a question from Jason Weatherholt. Since this is obviously a pagonging, who goes next? Is that obvious?
I don't think it's obvious. Certainly not after this vote. You know, Christian and
it's
Gabby
just
went against. And in fact, this was like definitionally not a pagonging as Carl went home.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Maybe he sent that before. Maybe he sent that after Alec.
Could have been earlier in the night. Okay. Here's one from R. Gray Shaw. I think that Angelina helped herself a little with that whole negotiation move. Do you think? You know, did Angelina put herself in a position where she was like, oh, no. No, we got to take her to the end. Do you hear her going on and on about this move she made with the rice?
Yeah. Well, do you mean she helped herself because people are more convinced that they can beat her now?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. I don't know if Angelina necessarily helped her ultimate game there. You know, Andy Dennard actually noticed, and this is a little bit of a digression, that the last couple seasons, right, Jeff made a thing that we're giving them less rice, you know, we're giving them less food, which basically kind of inevitably was going to lead to a situation like this. Like, this was something that they were looking for. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and what they were going for was that, no, that they won't vote out the providers.
Yep, still voted out the providers. Who are the providers?
We saw Christian go try to go catch fish one time.
I guess that's right. It was Christian. Yeah. They haven't voted him out yet.
Yeah. So he's a provider. Okay. Let's take this question. This is from Henry. Is Drunk Carl one of the best drunk survivors that we had on the show? Obviously, you know, I did a podcast last year of the best survivor drunk moments.
That's really fun. That's a good one.
Did we have a one singular Drunk Carl moment?
Not really. I mean, there was it was more of like an extended, sequence of events.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A sequence of drunk events.
So, yeah. I'm not sure if we have a moment that will crack the top 11.
What was the best one? Was it Brian or Tom Westman? Was a pretty,
that was good. Right? Yeah. Don't quiz me right now on the list. I don't have it. I don't have it at my fingertips. You guys can search it in the archives of Robin's podcast.
Yeah.
Hey, what about Amanda Fallon?
Amanda Fallon wants to know, why didn't we get Davey's thoughts about the Carl vote? Yeah, why didn't we get Davey's thoughts?
Well, did he vote for Carl?
No, he voted for Allison.
So, I mean, I think that Nick and Davey and Carl were all on the same page. I don't know what, you know, that they felt like, okay, well, this is an easy vote. Let's vote out Allison.
I'll bet we get his thoughts next week.
I bet he's not going to be happy.
Yeah, probably not going to be happy.
Yeah. How about when Davey was, him and Carl, they just cleaned up on that basketball challenge.
I love that moment where Davey afterwards was like, I am now an athlete. Like, I can say I'm an athlete. That was so fun, especially because at the start of the episode, you had him saying, you know, I've got to like do this. Well, what was it? It was like, he had to do something because he's never going to win. Oh, he has to find the advantages. You open the episode with him saying, I've got to find these advantages because I'm terrible at these challenges. And then he does awesome in a challenge. I thought it was really fun.
Well, I'll tell you, like, how little do I know? And I'm so happy I watched Survivor and I learned so much stuff. And Davey talked about how that, you know, his friends at home are always trying to take away his black card. And I was like, oh my God, Davey has an American Express card with no limit?
I don't know about that.
Yeah. I was like, wow. I was like, boy, okay. Davey must be a high roller.
Okay.
I didn't even know that. And then it's like, oh, I didn't. Hold on. I didn't even know. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Steven. Sorry, I don't mean to throw you off, Steven. Steven Fishback has a black
whenever
card.
Whenever I talk about credit cards, I get very, you know, very passionate.
Yes, so, you know. American Express black card. Yeah. Zach, they like only give those out to a couple people, Steven.
That's like the super prestigious one? I thought that was the one that was like the... No. Oh, I'm thinking of the platinum. Wait, what's the one that's like $400 and you have like access to all the airlines?
Oh, I don't know. I don't see. Oh, yeah, okay. All right, we'll figure that out. We'll have a credit card know-it-alls. Zach Wright, if you're forced to put all your eggs in the same jacket, should they be poached or scrambled first? There you go with that one.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Eggs in the same jacket.
Couldn't believe we were going back to eggs again tonight. Delivery Jay.
That was one of your all-time great tweets.
Don't
put all your eggs in one jacket.
Yeah. Yeah. Delivery Jay wants to know, when did we get that Carl was a godfather before this episode?
Came out of nowhere. But, you know, I mean, Gabby's point about this episode, it seemed like everyone, like multiple people were like, Alec asked, who's the leader of the Davids? It's Carl. Mike is like, yeah, Carl's leading the Davids. And Gabby's rationale, and this actually we didn't really talk about, Gabby's rationale for voting out Carl, in addition to their, you know, their animosity, was
that with Carl there, no one is going to give them credit for their moves, which I thought was really interesting because like everyone's going to think Carl is calling all the shots. I mean, do you think there's something to that, Rob, of like voting out the person who you think is getting all the credit for all the moves?
I mean, he did, you know, it seemed like that from what we saw last week, where in the discussion after the episode, I think that us in the, you know, Survivor, you know, Greek chorus, I think that we were more focused on the story that was told from Nick's perspective of it was Nick's vote steal that won the day. But it seemed like that to the actual survivors, maybe it was more Carl's idol nullifier was what really won the day. And that Carl was getting a lot of credit. And he was also the person who was sort of the David Strong. And that looked like that was going to win. And so I think that he may have been sort of like an Andrew Savage in terms of like that he was sort of like being seen as more out in front as like the leader of this group. And so nobody else, if that group gets to the end, that person is typically rewarded, you know, as the winner of the game because that they were sort of like the captain of that ship. And then ultimately, they ended up, you know, knocking him out.
Yeah. But I think there's something to it. You know, you want to get the credit for your own moves.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
There's something else on that I wanted to get into, and I can't remember what it was, but we'll come back to it. This is one from Henry. Did Angelina really just insinuate that her not competing to get Rice is a mark on her Survivor resume? Are you kidding me?
Yeah, I do think that's a mistake from Angelina. But I guess like from her perspective, like her superpower is negotiation. So if she goes out there and shows like, look, I'm using my superpower to help the team.
Steven, I don't know. You know, I got into this on the podcast with Sophie the other day, and we talked about resume because Sandra was really poo-pooing the resume among other things on the episode.
Yeah, I heard that Sandra was throwing a lot of poo-poo.
But I got into it with Sophie, and Sophie talked about the resume, and I asked Sophie about like, but do you buy into the resume stuff? And we sort of started to talk about, well, you know, survivors really shouldn't talk about their resume. They need to talk about their story. And Angelina actually said that she felt like that this helps her resume and her story to only confuse the issue. But I don't know necessarily when Angelina, you know, stands in front of the jury. And when you start talking about, I made this move on day 27, I did this on day 32, and I did this, blah, 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 like that's a resume. But the narrative that you try to sell to the, like, I was the person that, and I don't know if that necessarily fits her, like I was the person that, you know, would made endless sacrifice for the group. And another example of that was when I gave up the chance to play in the immunity challenge so that we could have Rice as the group. I don't know if that's her story.
That's a really great distinction, Rob. I think that's fantastic. And I'm glad. Thank you for sharing it with me. Because this issue of the resume there seemed like there's something there, but it's always seemed like a really reductive way of looking at the game a way of justifying terrible decisions. Oh, I'm going to do this insane thing because it will be on my Survivor resume. You know, Alec voting out Natalia, right? Oh, that's his resume point. P.S. That didn't work out for him. But you know, I think that to recontextualize that as like, what's my Survivor story? I think that's really, really smart. And like overall, what's that narrative you're going to be giving to the jury?
And your moves are part of your story where, you know, like if Allison can get to the end with Christian and Gabby and say like, look, I was the, you know, I was the Goliath and yes, I worked with the Goliaths, but I found common ground with the Davids. And so I was able to, you know, weave my way through the game. And I ended up, you know, throwing in my lot with the Davids. And that's how I got to this end. And I won challenges along the way because I used my Goliath power to, you know, carry me to victory. Like, you know, that's more of a story than necessarily like, you know, on this vote, I did this, at this vote, I did this.
Does that mean like you shouldn't do off-brand moves?
You should not do off-brand moves unless that you can say that. And then, because then once everybody had thought that I was this, then I proved that I was actually this. And so, like a sort of like, you know, sort of like a final reveal. I think you
right. So if your whole thing is like I was loyal to the Davids, then you can't have that, like, except for that one right. vote where I was disloyal to the Davids.
Right. And, yeah. And if your story is that I was a loyal and, you know, person that I played with honesty and integrity, and then you didn't do that, then that doesn't, you know, that doesn't really add up. And especially if in terms of your perceptions or the jury's perceptions of you in the final three.
Yeah. Yeah. That's, I love that. That's a really great, was that you or Sophie?
I will have to go back and check the tape.
You don't want to take credit. I was just trying to rank my friends.
It's like if we're having a conversation and we arrive at something. Yeah. It's like, you know, how much of it was me? How much of it was you?
It's probably mostly me.
Yeah. It's like liquids mixed together. Who can tell?
Yeah.
Okay.
You know what? That's one thing I love about Christian is that he will take, you know, he's saying the same things that we've heard so many times, but he's saying them with this unique perspective that's so distinct for his character. It's just great to hear some of the same thing with a unique.
Do you like a poached egg?
I do. I've recently, like, my wife loves poached eggs, and she's really, I've always been like a scrambled eggs guy. And then if I go out, you know, if I go to a diner, I'm getting sunny side up, mm-hmm. but my wife has really gotten me into the poached eggs.
I tried to make one recently. Did not go well.
Yeah, it's hard. It's that's that, but that's why it's a nice thing to order.
Didn't
like,
go well. Didn't go well.
You got yolk everywhere.
It was just like a egg drop soup. It was like, what is this? Yeah. What is this? Threw yeah. it out. It was like, it didn't work. Okay. All right. Then John Densford. Does anybody know what Angelina didn't offer up in her negotiation with Bros?
Yeah, I guess that's right. Yeah. She started with basically everything. Brian Kelly just tweeted, I thought it was funny that we got to see Angelina's culinary negotiation skills in action. She tried to get her meal at a discount.
Oh, that's how she gets the meal at a discount. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. I like that.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
All right. Brent, the great Brendan Fitzpatrick asks, Mason and Dixon both now have idols. Who do you expect to play theirs first? Worth a knowingest know-it-all bet. Interesting.
So that's a very specific bet. Who is going to play an idol first, Christian or Nick?
I think we would both say Christian.
I think I would say Nick. Only because Nick was on the wrong side of the vote this last time out.
I guess so. And I'm a little bit nervous making this bet because they did set up a Christian blindside. Now, granted, every preview has set up a Christian blindside.
Yes,
but
every single time so far.
Yeah. I think every single time. I guess that's just because like we all care. We're all like his, you know, his mother. We all like want to like protect him and keep him safe.
Okay. Well, we don't look. I don't want to force you into anything. And this is from Akash. The second tribal council tonight was so dumb. Allison gets to the end. She gets all the Goliath votes. Carl gets to the end. Who the hell is voting for him? Well, they're already talking about him as the godfather.
Yeah. I think that's, I mean, I guess that's it, right? Like, I think this is one of those points where there's a discrepancy between our perception as audience and the viewer's perception and then the player's perception. Wait, Rob, I wanted to talk to you about that Nick, did you like that Nick idol find? Do you like that scenario, like go to the end of the island?
Yeah, I thought it was okay. I was expecting it to be like one more thing. It was
one
like,
more hurdle.
Okay,
yeah.
Sneak out at night. Okay, good. And, you know, it was very reminiscent of when Jeremy had to leave camp. And it seemed like that Nick then definitely did have to go far. But it wasn't, I think, as compelling as when Chris Noble had to then get on a boat and go to Ghost Island and sneak out. And then, you know, so I thought it was okay, but, you know, not stellar.
And what I liked about the Chris Noble scene is there's a real sacrifice involved, and like you're not going to be able to. I'm just obviously there was like, do you risk your vote or whatever? But the fear of not being able to get any sleep that night. I agree. It was a little like too easy for me. You know, there was very spooky and it was a cool scene, but the threat of is Allison going to find out? Never really. It didn't seem like a real danger. And you know, Davey playing lookout. What was he looking out for?
I don't know. Well, I don't know what he's going to do. So I thought that then when he got to the thing that he was going to have to then complete a task or something like that and do a final step. So it was something. I mean, it was a little bit different than what we normally get in terms of the idol find. So I appreciate that the effort, but I felt like that it was still a little bit lacking.
Yeah. But I found that there was a clue and then there was one additional hurdle. I still love the idols under your shelter. I think that's a fun one they should bring back.
Okay. I mean, we just had it last season.
Oh, yeah, I guess we did just have it.
Oh, I said, I mean, it was okay. Let's do a couple more questions. I mean, you didn't even remember that we just had it last season. So I mean,
no, I was thinking of Wentworth, but yeah, you're right.
Okay. Then this is one from John. What do you think it means for Nick's game moving forward, given that he was left out of the vote since Tribal Lines Are No More? Could he be on the outs? Now, Nick did find the idol, but I do think that, you know, in terms of following last week's episode, I know that there was a lot of high praise for Nick, but I felt like that overall this was a quiet 2 hours for Nick.
Yeah, there was, I think that's right. I mean, he found the idol, but we didn't see him as being super integral to any of the big strategic calculations.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think that means for him overall?
Well, I'm not allowed to talk about the edit.
Well, in terms of that, it seems like that he's sort of all in with the, in terms of like the, you know, I think that when, you know, at the, when Nick's stock was at its absolute apex, probably, I think you felt like, okay, well, he's got a thing with Christian, he's got a thing with Alec, he's got a thing with Mike, he's got a thing with Davey.
Right.
But it seems like that he is actually, after finding that other idol with Davey, it feels like that he's really thrown his lot in with Davey and Carl.
Yeah, it does seem that he's really David Strong. And it's like, how did the Davids go wrong, Rob? That's what I want to know. You know, it was this dream. It was this impossible dream that just for a brief,
I'll tell you what happened, Stephen.
You know,
the Davids became Goliaths.
I think that is what happened. I think that's what happened.
They were the underdogs. You know. They had that big underdog energy, and then they got the numbers and said, "Hey, we're Goliaths now." And then the Goliaths became Davids.
The funny thing is they became complacent even before they became like they actually had the numbers, like when it was even numbers and they were a little bit complacent.
Mm-hmm.
But I will say that having been in both the dominant position and the underdog position, there's something so nice about when you get to that dominant position. You're like, oh, my God, I'm controlling the game. Everyone, like I for X number of days have been scrambling to get in people's good graces. And now people are scrambling to get in my good graces. Like, this is really fun. I'm going to enjoy this for a minute. And obviously, you know, this is Survivor. You can't enjoy it for a minute.
Yeah. So I'm trying to think of where exactly they did go wrong. So, I mean, voting out Alec was fine for the Davids, but then maybe Allison. You know, honestly, that Carl was too cute with the, hey, let's not tell Gabby about this vote, and then let me tell Christian. And so, I mean, if you want to pinpoint exactly where they went wrong, then, hey, we're five Goliaths or five Davids or, you know, I guess Freudian slip. We're five Davids. Yeah. Let's just vote our five against one person and not get fancy with, okay, we're not going to tell Gabby that it's going to be Allison.
I totally agree. That's where it went wrong. And they should have reached a tribal consensus, you know, just like they should have sat down. Who do the five of us want? I was sympathetic to Gabby when she got so upset. She's like, I'm walking up in a conversation about who's getting voted out that you're having with Kara, who's like theoretically the enemy. And I don't even know, you know, what we're talking about, where the votes are going.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I like that Christian was trying to interpret why Gabby was upset.
Christian is everyone is he's always hugging.
He explains everything. It's like,
yeah, but
go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
No.
I have to give some of this blame though to Davey and Nick too, because that they had to have known that when Carl says, "Okay, here's the plan. We're voting off Allison," and then, but I don't want to tell Gabby about it. I think that Davey or Nick, and maybe more Nick, has to say, "I think we got to tell her. I think either we got to tell her or we got to pick a different target." But then once we tell Christian, he's going to tell Gabby. And like, I think that they could have, you know, you didn't have to have like, you know, ESP to know that this was all going to happen.
Yeah. Yeah. It did seem just like a little bit of carelessness.
Carelessness.
No, really. Too much care.
Carlessness.
Yeah. Carlessness.
Steve, I'll tell you what the kiss of death was for Carl.
Yeah.
Did you see him come back from that reward and get in that hammock?
That's what I wrote. That was my blog. You never want to be the guy in the hammock.
Yes. So once you get into that, once you get into that position, once you get horizontal and you're telling people what to do, you're horizontal, they're standing. It's a bad look. That every single person that we've ever seen in the history of the show telling people what the vote is while laying in the hammock, it never has worked once.
It's not a great move. You never want to be, it's this position that just makes people resent you. Like, I'm going to lie back while I tell you what to do. It's just like the literal optics of it are terrible.
So bad. So bad.
Yeah.
So just remember, for all of you future Survivor players playing in Survivor season 39, 40 and beyond, if you are prone, you're going home. If you're laying down, you won't be around.
Do you work on this? Like, do you have this written down? This is just off the top of your head.
Yeah.
You've got a gift.
Oh, thank you, Stephen.
You should do something with it. Yes, you should pursue.
I'm thinking of starting a podcast.
Yeah, me too.
Yes. Okay. Anything else from tonight?
No, this was it was a sort of these were not like our major power players that we've seen. And yet, nevertheless, it was really two exciting episodes, a great season. I'm really, really excited about it. Who's winning the game, Rob?
Boy, I felt like coming into this week, I would have said that Nick was the front runner, but now I really don't know.
Yeah. My two are Christian and Kara.
Christian and Kara.
Those are my two.
I will say that Christian, I could, you know, if he can figure this out, I feel like if he gets to the end with Gabby and with Allison, I feel like that he's the winner there. I feel like that that he wins out of that three. If ultimately, though, I do feel like that this is the first night that at least I can see a path for Kara, where up until this point I could not. I think that Mike is not dead in the water.
Yeah. Mike is interesting. I mean, Mike, you know, I just can't imagine them awarding the $1 million to a wealthy screenwriter, director, actor.
I can't see it, but I felt like that this might have been his best night tonight.
Yeah, this was a good night for Mike.
I feel like that was the best night for him. And then I feel like that Davey and Nick, who were probably my one and two coming into this week, like I can't forget about them. So I feel like that of the eight people left, like I can squint hard enough and at least see, you know, and then Angelina's the person that I feel like that, you know, everybody would love to take to the end.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it does seem like everyone's got a shot, and I think that's one of the most exciting. You know, those are always the best seasons when we feel like you can see a rationale for how all the players could possibly win.
I mean, and you know, this is not a hot take, but you're super high on this season.
Oh, I love it. I really am. Yeah. I mean, I'm like really debating with the question of like Cagayan versus this. I mean, obviously we have to see how this. I mean, I think the trump card that Cagayan will always have that no other season will ever have is Tony, and just like the pure insanity and brilliance he brought to the show. Mm-hmm. It was this like X factor. But there were some slow episodes in Cagayan, right? I mean, I haven't
watched
it. There's
a couple. It's a little bit different where I feel like that there are, you know, some play. Like if you go through the cast of Cagayan, you can come up with a couple people, you know, that are not super exciting, not to name names. And I feel like that this cast overall, like the mean of this cast, I think is overall higher. But then you have an all-timer in, you know, in Tony. And so I think that is super memorable. And then somehow he won on top of all that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that was it. Like Tony winning, like this insane lunatic and his completely absurd strategies that he put into play. Like,
Steven, so tell me that, and I know the chat wants to know, who got the fishy today? Do you give multiple fishy on a 2-hour episode? Can I ask that?
I think I have the right to, but I didn't. I just gave one fishy. I gave it to Gabby.
Gabby. That's interesting.
I think Gabby was the only, like I said earlier, I think that Gabby's play to eliminate Carl, I think eliminating Carl made sense for Gabby in a way that it didn't necessarily make sense for anybody else, except Allison, obviously.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I mean, I think that she, when Gabby tells her story, I do think that this is probably, the number one headline on that story, where she was the one that then she worked with the Davids and then, you know, made her own path. Once Carl left her out, she had to, go out on her own.
Do you think there's a chance of, like, you know, the three people who said ding, and they did say ding. I do
tonight
believe
they
Carl
definitely said
ding.
Ding.
Tonight they said ding. I'm almost positive Carl said bing.
Carl, it sounded like bing.
It's weird that, like, no one said, like, what did you say, Carl? Did you say bing or did you say ding?
We can ask him tomorrow.
No, I mean, on the island. Like, why didn't they say, like, if he said bing, why are they saying ding?
You want to see that on the show?
No, I'm just saying they should have gotten their ducks in a row.
You want to see that moment at Tropicana? Like, Carl, did you just say bing? Like, no, I said ding.
It really
sounded like bing. Like, no, I said
I
ding.
See the results. I just want to see them saying the word correctly because they had the foresight to do the research. But it was interesting that the three people who said ding were the three women. Right, Kara, Allison, and Gabby. Is there a chance for a ding-based women's alliance here?
And so the dingers are Gabby and Kara and Allison.
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. Interesting. And Christian gets left out. I mean, all season long he was Gabby's champion, and then ultimately gets thrown away. Like
no ding.
Yesterday's
I mean,
news.
That would be the other side of Gabby's story, right? Which was like all season long, I've been, in Christian's shadow, and this was my move to come out of his shadow.
Wow. Okay. Look, yeah. I'm here for it. 3 weeks from tonight, Stephen Fishback, is the finale of Survivor David versus Goliath. Can you believe it?
Will you text me and let me know who wins?
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Steven's going to be honeymooning for finale night. So we've only got two more weeks here with Stephen Fishback in Survivor David versus Goliath.
But then your replacement for me is got a lot more votes than I did. So,
Yeah. Oh, we've got a really big finale show planned. I'm going to be here with you guys live after the season finale of Survivor coming up in 3 weeks from tonight. Okay. So let's talk about what's coming up here on Rob Has a Podcast. Hey, look, RuPaul's Drag Race All-Stars 4. Wow, the fourth All-Stars of RuPaul's Drag Race, Stephen.
Yeah.
So check that out. Season preview is coming up on the reality TV Rehab Ops. And then Survivor double exit interview coming up. Very excited about that one. Plus, Jacob Derwin joins me for the This Week in Survivor History quiz. Very fun. Of course, Todd Herzog coming on to talk with me about the double episode. Todd is pumped up and ready to go. He's really loving this season. And so we'll talk to Todd on Thursday. Send your questions in Survivor at Rob's website if you have those. And then Jessica Lease is going to be on the B&B. She and I just finished recapping the Walking Dead mid-season finale. Check out Jessica Lease this week on the B&B with Liana and Mike. And then a double episode of Why Blank Lost this week. Why did Alec lose? Why did Carl lose? We'll find out on Why Blank Lost on our Rehab Ups channel and in the Survivor feed. And then Rourke Luskin will be here with me in the studio to get into all of your feedback. That's going to be on Saturday, so you guys have a little bit of time to send in your questions. Leave us your feedback from this week's double episode. Of course, special thanks to all of the Rob Has a Podcast patrons who make all of this podcasting about these wonderful reality TV shows possible. Thank you guys so much for your ongoing support of Rob Has a Podcast, closing in on 5 years from when I was able to podcast full time. Thank you to the support of the Rob Has a Podcast patrons. Find out more information at robhaswebsite.com/patron. All right, Stephen. There you have it.
Good stuff. It sounds like a big week coming up.
Good stuff. Okay, Steven, so do you have a launch date for your new venture?
I'm still trying to get a few ducks in a row, like locking down a logo, locking down a website. So I'm hoping to get it out by the end of next week.
But this is good that you put your vision out there to the universe, and now you can't back out. You've come too far, because then people are going to say, like, hey, Steven, when is that podcast that you said you were making going to come out? Oh, so now, once it's been released to the world, now you will have people haunting you forever until it comes out.
Yeah. Well, I've recorded a couple of episodes, but I'm just so excited that I'm totally geeking out that I'm launching with Jeff Vandermeer. He's, you know, an idol of mine. So the fact that I get to talk to him tomorrow, I'm very, very nervous about it.
Do you have any survivor authors lined up? Philip Shepard?
Yeah. That will be once I've run out of every other author. Okay. I'll get to Rupert, Coach, you know,
Boston Rob, so, rule book.
Boston Rob. Yeah. That will be at the end of time when that will happen.
I think Rachel Aiko wrote a book, I believe.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Okay. All right, Stephen Fishback. Great work once again. Looking forward to getting back into it after the final eight. Follow Stephen Fishback on Twitter and be sure to check out his people.com strategy blog, where he lays everything out about Carl laying out and everything else from this episode. All right, Stephen?
You put a lot of sizzle into that. That was a great his strategy blog. A lot of sizzle. Yeah, I like that.
Maybe it's this RuPaul's Drag Race 4 or All-Stars 4 coming back.
Yeah, so you all sizzled up.
All right. Have a good one, everybody. Take care. Bye.
Bye.